Hello, this is Mayor Jim Darling. This is our City of McAllen legislative update. And today we have a very special guest, our State Representative Sergio Muñoz Jr. from District 36. Welcome.
Thank you, Mayor, for having me.
So the session's in going strong now and pretty exciting. And, you know, before we start talking about the bill, let's talk about your role up in the legislature and the committees you're appointed to. You're on the insurance committee.
Yes, sir. This is my third session in the legislature. I started in 2011. This session, I have the honor to continue to be a member of the Appropriations Committee on Insurance and Local and Consent Calendars.
Now, third session sounds like kind of a new guy, but actually it's not in these legislatures. You're kind of a middle guy, actually.
Yeah, in 2011, when I first came in my first session, we had a very large freshman class. And subsequent to that, obviously there's been a lot of change, a lot of movement, and, you know, a lot of the elections that have come and gone. You know, now I sit at about low 70s in seniority out of the 150-member body, which I think is important for all of us here because, you know, the longer we're there and the more seniority we have, the more, you know, positions we can be a part of that I think we can continue to bring back and represent our districts well.
Yeah, I remember you kind of did what you really should do as a freshman, listened a lot and absorbed a lot. And so now you're in the middle there, so people should be listening to you some. And so how has that changed in roles and relationship with you personally and then dealing with other legislators?
Yeah, I think it's important. Not only, you know, me personally, I have a lot of respect for the institution and the legislature. And that's why it's not only an honor to be a part of it, but also to bring about positive change, I think, to our community and to our state. And it's been important ever since, even it's something that I still do this session. And it's always, you know, you look out for advice and you seek advice from some of the members that have been there, you know, a lot longer than I have. And I try to use some of their skills or some of their recommendations in terms of, you know, not only trying to navigate the legislative process, but also trying to become a member as well that is respected among the body. And we are going to get to a certain point that, you know, people are going to come seeking our advice and trying to do the same thing. And that's why if we not only continue to learn about the process and learn about the institution, but also become a member that people can seek out and seek for advice, regardless of political affiliation, but just someone that is knowledgeable about the issues, we not only make the state better, but we also continue to help the members of the legislature as well.
I don't want to get into too much of the politics of what goes on in Austin, but it seems it's gotten more conservative even in the last 6 years for you. And I noticed some of the votes are coming out 140-12 and some of those. And, of course, our delegation is Democrat, all Democrat. And how does that affect you, and how is it different this session than prior session?
Yeah, I mean, this session for us in the House of Representatives, we had a speaker's race, you know, the first day of session, which we hadn't had in I don't know how many years. And, you know, I guess just as the state changes, the policies change as well. But I've always been of the opinion that, you know, once we're there and we've been elected to represent our district and to really represent people of this state, we need to put some of our differences aside and even political affiliation at times because, you know, public education, healthcare, transportation, economic development, jobs, I mean, those are not partisan issues. Those are Texas issues. And we're all there to make a difference, you know, for our state. And the more we can think that way and, I guess, look at improving the quality of life for the people of this state, then the more we can accomplish.
Now, on the insurance, on the committee, insurance committee, it's you really oversight the Texas Department of Insurance. That's a lot of industry lobbyists kind of control that agenda to a certain extent. Anything bubbling up there that we should know about?
Yeah, this is my second session on insurance, and one of the things that we're really looking at this time around is, you know, Texas Department of Insurance as a whole, I think, for a while now has been an agency that maybe has not really been something that we've focused on as much as we should have in terms of making sure that its intent and its purpose is being fulfilled, and that is not only to be fair to the industry, but also to be fair for the consumer, and that's where we need neutrality in their position and the way they operate, because there has to be a balance.
So you're vice chair, so you get exposed to a lot of that kind of stuff and sorting it out, this consumer versus the industry. You want to have strong industry, you want to have a strong insurance industry, but you have to be careful of the consumers and
It's a difficult balance, and but I think it's important, and you know, on insurance or any other issue, we should all approach it with an open mind and listen to both sides. But I think TDI is no different than any other state agency, and that is that it's there to serve our constituents, there to serve the people of the state. And we got to make sure that whether it's TDI or other state agencies, that that intent is very clear, is that they're here to represent everybody and offer a service to everybody from the state, regardless of their economic situation or background, whatever. And, you know, they need to provide that service, and the legislature needs to make sure that they're providing that service, you know, in a fair manner.
Now, a real big buzz years ago was always the uninsured motorist, and you don't hear as much about that. I think it's more difficult to get your registration without insurance, and so that's not a, doesn't seem to be an issue on anybody's front burner.
Yeah, it's all, you know, the insurance in general, whether that's home, property, casualty insurance, health insurance, car insurance, definitely in this state, in in Texas, and even in this day and age, we're not only always trying to look at ways to make it more affordable and accessible, but the more people we can have covered within any one of those facets, I think the better it is for all of us here.
I know one of the things I heard from some of the insurance industry side was with the hail damage. They had one in Dallas, was almost as severe as in the Valley, is lawsuit abuse.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to write policies in certain areas of the state because of the judicial system there, or at least the leaning towards the plaintiff's bar. That's really not something, the subject that the TDI can deal or your committee, but I think it's something that I'm sure the lobbyists.
Yeah, it's a combination that we've been hearing, not only on the insurance side for the insurance committee, but also looking at the committee on civil and civil jurisprudence as well in terms of the litigation. But you know, like in anything that we do, I think we need to find that balance that is beneficial to everybody that is involved.
Now, locum consents. Everybody said, what is that? It's not a very glamorous committee, but that's where you can kill a lot of bills, I guess, right?
Yeah, local and consent committee is very similar to, of course, our calendars committee, and local consent is usually for legislation that are either local bills or uncontested, meaning that they had a unanimous vote out of any one of our substantive committees in the House of Representatives. And you know, once you become a part of that committee, sometimes you become everybody's friend, or sometimes you can become everybody's enemy. But definitely people are a lot nicer to you when you're in a committee where if they do have local bills, they definitely want to seek you out and make sure that you're going to be supportive of it.
I noticed, too, that sometimes it's hard to determine what happened to a bill in that committee, and nobody usually takes responsibility when it gets killed.
Yeah,
a lot of that's going on.
Yeah, a lot of that going on, and, you know, even within our rules, if a bill has been referred to that committee and it is not set on the local consent calendar within 30 days, and after the 31st day, it is automatically transferred to the calendars committee, which is the overall committee that sets the general calendar for the House.
So that's a good committee to be on.
Yeah, so definitely, you know, it's been my, this is also my second session on that committee, and so I've been very grateful and honored to serve, and I want to continue my service on there to the best of my ability.
Now, you're on the fancy, the flashy one, that's appropriations. and, you know, the word out is we're going to have less money because oil and gas prices are down. Affects even McAllen, who has an overriding interest. So, and then you heard about the budget cuts and those kind of things. What's going to result of that? Is that going to be a big debate, or is everybody in agreement yet? Or?
Yeah, well, you know, since 2011, when a lot of the cuts were implemented by the legislature at that time, which was something that I did not support, because I think we could have addressed it a lot differently. But subsequent to that, last session, because of our economic position as a state, we were able to restore a lot of that funding in the different programs within our budget. This session, we're still in a very good budget economic situation. Although we have to be very cautious and conservative in what we're doing because of the concern with the oil and gas industry and so forth. But there is definitely enough revenue to cover growth within our programs, et cetera. The biggest question right now is the property tax cuts and how we're going to accomplish that. And that definitely plays a big part in being able to access revenue for the next 2-year cycle.
Yeah, when you take a look at it, there is no state property tax. You have a franchise tax, which is really the corporate income tax, for lack of a better term, and then oil and gas revenues and fees. And so there's not, when you look at the state, there's just not a lot of buckets. Mm-hmm. You can go and say, we're going to cut here, and property tax kind of seems to be the sacrificial cow.
Yeah, and a lot of times, you know, we we all, I think, want to be in a position where we want to pay less property taxes, or we want to pay less taxes, period. I don't think anybody can argue with that. However, how we accomplish that is really the ongoing discussion. And, you know, as a state as diverse and as, you know, being in a point that we're at with the amount of growth that we've experienced, we are going to be in a position to have more pressing needs, you know, throughout our state and in whatever program we're looking at. So as a state, I think if we're looking at prosperity and setting us up for success, I mean, if we're going to experience that growth, there is going to be increased costs in the way we operate, you know, education, healthcare, transportation, issues that affect us all on a daily basis. And if we can meet those needs and we can make sure that we're funding, you know, increased growth and so forth, then we can not only make sure we're taking care of our needs for the next 2-year cycle, and if there's an opportunity to return money to the taxpayer, we definitely want to consider that as well.
I've been around like 36 years now, and they've always struggled with that. You know, they had state property tax at one point, and there was a personal property tax, local one that was an option, and that keeps going around and around. I don't think it's ever not been in litigation, by the way, between the poor district school districts and the rich school districts, and that's always been a problem. I don't know if there's a remedy to that, but the whole idea is opportunity for everybody, and it should be as much as an equal opportunity as it can be, and that doesn't seem to be achievable.
Yeah, definitely, and that's one of the issues now, even in drafting the budget, we're mindful of, because the district court has already ruled, and we know it's already all the way up to the Supreme Court. Now that they've given a briefing schedule and so forth, that puts us into a timetable that's a little bit farther down the regular legislative session. So for us in the House and our proposed budget so far, we not only have, when you look at public education, we not only have funded enrollment growth, but we've put in an additional $2 billion on top of that because of the increased revenue from property taxes, et cetera, into the funding formulas. Now, addressing the inequities and the formulas in general, I think, is still something that remains to be resolved. And we're hopeful, I think, that we can have that discussion, meaningful discussion, soon in the legislature.
Do you think the legislature get tired of the courts deciding this all the time and get real with things that really work? But it doesn't seem, they kind of let it go to the court, and then they take the court says, here's some guidance, take a whack at it, and right back in court again.
Yeah, and we're also, you know, at the mercy of the court as well, is that, you know, any type of plan or that we develop that has to do with the formulas and the funding has to go back to the court for review. So basically we can come up with something, send it to the court, and they could say, you know what, that's not what we want, that's not good enough, and send it right back to us, and you know, we have to come up with something again. But I definitely agree is that, you know, at some point in time on so many issues, we just look at, it seems that it's just, let's make a decision right now and you know, kicking the can down the road, you know, we hear that phrase a lot and worrying about it later. But there are definitely pressing needs that need to be addressed at some moment in time. And, you know, for all of us that are elected, people expect us to take a leadership role and make decisions for everybody. And we need to address it as soon as possible.
One of the things that we're always concerned about is cities. And I'm on the TMO board. I don't know if I should say that on TV. But at any rate, is you know, the state seems to be, the theme is local control as it relates to the state of Texas and the federal government. But then the next sentence is, we want to control local government. And so local control only ends at Austin in the state house and doesn't extend to individual cities. And, you know, as a city official, I always think, well, they can vote me out of office a lot easier. They can vote a state rep or a senator out of office normally. And so local control,
we would hope, right?
Should go both ways.
Huh? We would hope so.
And so, what gets done in Austin is a little harder to follow.
Yeah.
And so that's just a natural thing. What we do here is a little more direct. And so, I don't know how you feel. I think I know how you feel about local control, but I agree. I think, you know, Washington should leave Texas alone and Austin should leave McAllen alone to a certain extent.
Yeah, definitely. I think, you know, just like we rely on our local municipalities, our leaders within our communities, elected officials, to come to us, for example, either a state representative or senator, sometimes asking for legislation or tools really that the city needs, to better do their job, we definitely work on issues as well. But we have to always be mindful as well that even out of Austin, if you want cities to have that flexibility and the ability to really govern their own communities, then if there are times for us, the legislature, not to be involved, we need to be conscious of that as well.
Yeah. I always tell, you know, in general law, cities are cities under 5,000, and they have to look to the legislature for their authority to do things. Under the Constitution, home rule cities over 5,000 have their own charter, and that's a constitutional right of self-government. And I'm always surprised to see some of the rhetoric in Austin of saying they don't understand home rule, they don't understand it's a constitutional right, and they think, well, no, that's our duty to regulate cities. And so I'm always afraid when the city goes up to Austin, a home rule city, asks for permission to do something. Well, they've established now that for probably 700 cities or 500 cities that are home rule cities in Texas, and taking away local control for that issue.
Well, and it's not only the local control issue, right, and sometimes the double standard that we're seeing, but, I mean, we run into all the time in appropriations where, we want limited government, but then we're in situations where we're growing government in other aspects. So even me personally, I'm always trying to rationalize that as well.
Yeah, one of the things on appropriations is not our appropriations is revenue caps, and not only revenue caps, appraisal caps. And for those cities that really rely on an ad valorem tax, don't have a strong tax base or other revenues, that's important. That's our lifeguard against laying off people and providing services. And you know, I think the same thing, if you don't like what I tax rate I do, then vote me out of office. And I think that's the answer, instead of hampering local officials with making economic decisions.
Yeah, definitely. And even as a state, you know, in Austin, when we're drafting our budget and looking at the next two-year cycle, even when it comes to certain types of legislation, and I don't really want to say mandates, because sometimes that is a word that people don't take too kindly with, but sometimes when you're asking cities or municipalities to undertake certain initiatives, if the legislature is not giving you the tools or the funding to do them, then we're really just putting the burden on the local municipality to find a way to do it, you know, whether that's through taxes or another
right.
way. And that goes across many facets, especially even on the educational front.
Sure, and we call them unfunded mandates.
Yeah.
There's a lot. I don't know how many bills that got filed to date, probably about 4,000, I guess. And there's a lot of unfunded mandates.
Yeah,
in
definitely.
There.
And, you know, just like I remember in 2011, my first session, there was a lot of discussion and chatter saying, you know, if you have a piece of legislation that has a fiscal note, meaning that it's going to cost money, it's going to be very difficult for you to even get it set on the calendar, or you know, don't even think that it's going to get anywhere because it's spending money. My third session now is, seeing pieces of legislation that are costing the state money. Some have made it through the process already, some have not. But it definitely is always interesting to see the legislative process at work.
You know, the federal government has a pay-for rule. And I thought, well, okay, in other words, if I want to do something that costs money, you have to show where money's being saved. If that was the case, you'd have a balanced budget, I understood. That's not the case. So it's kind of political rhetoric that's pay-for. And what it does is its ability to kill a bill more than anything else.
Yeah, and you know, here in Texas, because of the Constitution, we're only allowed to spend what we anticipate coming in for the next 2 years. And really, as a part of the legislature, that's one of our main goals, is to pass that budget within those constraints.
And we have to go, our Constitution's amended so much because we have to go out for a vote in order to issue debt, the state does. And generally, I can't remember a debt issue in the Constitution being turned down by the state. If it has, it's been quite a while. So I think the voters are pretty confident of the fiscal responsibility of the legislature.
Yeah, we work within the confines of, looking at the anticipated revenue coming in with a comptroller, and then trying to make sure we meet the state's needs within those confines. And then as we go through session, we're also going to get like an updated revenue estimate for the comptroller, and then that'll determine also, is there going to be a anticipated more revenue coming in, or maybe a little bit decrease, and do we need to make any adjustments before we pass that budget bill?
Yeah, it's a pretty strong, Texas has historically been stronger than most states, certainly in the Northeast and out West.
Yeah, definitely. We have to look at not only meeting the pressing needs of our state and making sure that, you know, for all of us that are working with taxpayer money, we're transparent and truthful in where we're spending it. There's a lot of discussion for us in terms of the budget, even within our committee, on dedicated fees. You know, people that pay fees or certain fees for certain things that are intended to go for a specific purpose, but for many years are being used to certify the budget, and you know, only a small amount goes to its dedicated purpose, and the rest goes into the general fund. And we need to, I think, work to get away from that and to be truth, I think, to the taxpayers and to those that are paying these fees for whatever it is.
Yeah, I think if I had one criticism, that would be it. And there's a lot of them. The electrical utility one was supposed to go for low income, never went, and build up over $100 million.
Call it diversions.
And that one just sat there because they didn't want to spend the money, and others go to other functions. And that's important. You know, the one that always gets us is the fines for municipal court. I think it's $84 now. The first $84 of a traffic ticket goes back to the state of Texas, some for restricted activity and some general fund. And, you know, we have people don't have that kind of income down here and get a traffic ticket, and so we have to run a court and police department. We don't have quotas. But if you get more than $100 is a lot of money.
Yeah, definitely.
For a red light or a speeding ticket. And yet, you don't have that margin. I mean, if somebody can't pay, the alternative is to go to jail. And so what's the choice for local government to try to run a court and police department where some of those revenues have to come from municipal court funds, and most of it goes to the state of Texas?
Yeah, and we run into that with the sporting good and sales tax.
Yeah.
And, you know, that whether that money is going back to a local park, grants, et cetera, that should have been done. And we've seen ever since last session some change to go away from that, although it's not going to happen overnight. But if we work every legislative session to get away from that, I think we can work towards ending a lot of that diversion and a lot of that money and really putting it back to its intended purpose the way it's collected initially.
Yeah, because otherwise, I guess the alternative would be raising sales tax, because that's the primary state revenue source, and nobody wants to do that, so they have all these diversions. And okay, I'm going to pay, when I buy it, whatever, I'm going to pay a little extra on that. And yeah, it's not really very transparent.
Yeah, definitely, and I think, you know, the people deserve that, we all should work to do that so people can know that exactly where their money is going.
Now, you have introduced 63 bills, last count I was, all good quality bills.
Everyone is
how many do you expect to pass?
Hopefully a big percentage of them. You know, some of those are pieces of legislation that affect the whole state. Others are local bills. But we definitely, you know, want to make sure we have a majority of them work through the legislative process.
Now, I know you've got a philosophy of no one left behind. You know, everybody should be participating in prosperity and education opportunities. And one of the bills you have is a free full day kinder for certain children.
Yeah, one of the early piece of legislation we filed was a full day pre-K, specifically targeting a lot of the more challenged socioeconomic areas of the state, which definitely affect us here in the Rio Grande Valley. And one of the things that we always wanted to be mindful of and consider is that, you know, studies time and time again have shown that when you have early intervention and you're able to make that difference in a child's life at an early stage, the results and the changes are phenomenal in terms of the literacy and their ability to do so much more. And because of the cuts in 2011, it forced a lot of our school districts to go from a full day to a half day and work around that. So we want to bring that back to the level that it should be, I think, to really serve the needs of our students within our communities. And there have been several initiatives that have been proposed from other legislators. Even the governor has called for a full day pre-K. So our perspective from our office is to make sure that we do something and that it does get passed, whether it's our bill or somebody else's. But when we're looking at quality and quantity, et cetera, we always have to be mindful as well that, you know, in different parts of a state, we face different challenges, and especially socioeconomic conditions that are not apparent in other parts of the state. And we want to make sure that we're rewarding, but we're also being able to give an opportunity to every student, regardless of their economic condition.
And kind of on the other end of the spectrum, you have a bill on 4-year degrees offered by community colleges.
Yeah, definitely what we've worked on is that, you know, our local community college, or South Texas College now, offers baccalaureate degrees. And there's been a cap for the longest time of 5 that the state legislature has imposed.
5 different kind of?
Yeah, a limit of 5 different degrees. And we're at at a point where we're already going to be, we're already nearing that cap or going to exceed that cap with the different initiative that SEC has already in place. So we're working with the Higher Education Coordinating Board to make sure we can lift that cap, obviously within certain limitations, but to make sure that if there is more opportunity, we're able to provide that for those that, that want to go that way.
And now we have a local member on the coordinating board. I think that'll probably help us.
You know, we're definitely going to be knocking on his door a few times.
That's a huge difference, you know, with the program in high schools, and kids could come out with an associate's degree and go back, go to the state of South Texas College. Not that UTRG is not a great institution, but it offers an alternative for kids and a really important opportunity, I think.
Yeah, we saw a very good partnership develop and working relationship between University of Texas, now UTRGV, and South Texas College in terms of making sure that a lot of the alignments, course curriculum, et cetera, were in line with one another. But definitely, even if you look within our communities, there is a lot of need, but a lot of opportunity, and we want to encourage people to go whichever route they feel best suits and highlights their skills.
Great. Now I want to talk a little bit about the Border Protection Bill. You know, nobody paid any attention to the border for years. We couldn't get people to pay attention to us. I think Governor Abbott came down here quite a bit. I think he's probably, as a governor, showed an awful lot of interest in our area. And now we got a lot of interest in our area. And so we have a border protection bill.
Yeah, I lost count how many elected officials, not only from this state, but throughout the country, came down to visit our famous border down here.
I just Googled border on the legislative thing, and it came up with over 100 bills. Yeah. Deal with. And this is the Representative Bunner's bill is the key bill, piece of legislation. And, you know, I thought about it, and it has two things. One is the nice part is it's kind of recognizes some of the criminal elements involved with illegal immigration. Because really the immigration issue for us had been families and children,
sure.
Not necessarily criminal, and that's what got the focal point for us. But now we've gotten some side attention to some of the other issues of illegal immigration.
Yeah, and you know, before we start the legislative session, even now, one of the difficulties that we're dealing with is that, you know, there has always been, I thought, some sort of an unwritten rule within the legislature that when you file legislation that affects a certain part of the state, especially a local community, that you would want local participation, or you would expect a member from that area to be involved in doing so. And because border security became such a phenomenon and we had so many people that were interested, and we have so many people now that, that want to, I think, dictate how we do things down here. But there's so much more behind that. I think there's so much more that needs to be done. There's so many facts sometimes that are left out of the equation. And
right.
And in crafting legislation and doing what we're doing, there have been some members that have reached out to us, and we're very grateful for that, because this is not only a South Texas, you know, issue, or I mean, and we're not going to have just a South Texas solution. I mean, safe communities are something that we need throughout our state.
Right, and you know, and what's happened to us is, from an economic development standpoint, with the National Guard and really bad publicity for us when we're trying to do economic recruiting. And I think at one point they talked about having some economic development money for us, because they are creating a problem for us here in the Valley that they didn't realize. And so all that's an element of. People need to think about how they're treating us.
Although we can't have it both ways, we can't say that we need so much more resources and infrastructure on the security standpoint, but then want to sort of backstop it with money for promotion of economic development. Then I think we're sending a mixed message, you know, because we're saying, no, it's not safe, so we need all of this.
Well, you know, we don't think, you know, if you take a look at it, really, the number of apprehensions of illegal immigrants is down. So really what caused all the attention was a surge of children and families. They're not causing a safety issue or a criminal issue at all. And so we've always had this problem, and it's actually, we've gained a lot of progress with the Border Patrol in that. And so, you know, the National Guard, I don't know why they needed to be there, to tell you the truth, except a political solution. And so it has hurt us economically. And so if you're gonna do a lot of rhetoric up there about how dangerous the border is, then you need to know the ramifications of it, and you need to help us a little bit. I'm not saying necessarily the legislation part of it.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the things that people were under the a different impression. That was, you know, the National Guard didn't really have any law enforcement authority. all they were serving for was observation and reporting back to DPS and others. But really, like I said, I think if we would just encourage more cooperation and participation, you know, with local, state, federal resources to address any type of security issue, I think the more we would be able to accomplish.
Well, in the criminals aren't staying here. I mean, they're doing, you know, stash houses and all that. They're going north. Okay. And that's why I always tell people, you think it's the problems here, you didn't look at your own city. I mean, our city's, like McAllen's, a 20-year low for crime, and right in the middle of all that, and so you think, wow. And how did that happen? Well, it's not. It didn't just happen. It's been like that, and it's a trend.
Yeah, and you know, in trying to work through this issue, one of the things I've wanted to communicate to the rest of my colleagues, even the leadership of this state, is, you know, personally, I take a lot of pride in the community that I grew up in, that I represent, you know, where I come from. I mean, I believe there's a lot of good-hearted, a lot of hardworking people. A lot of people that want to do their best for their families, for their children, and make them, you know, a better life. So I take a lot of pride in the community that I represent in the district. So definitely when people say something bad about it, you know, I feel sometimes maybe it's a little personal, you know, because we are a vibrant community. We are a vibrant part of the state, and we want to be team players just like anybody else. We want to be recognized for our positive contributions as well.
And one of the, to me, controversial parts is southbound checkpoints. And they want to do that to prevent smuggling and drug smuggling and actually not drug, probably, money and all those kind of things. And I just ran some statistics of bridge crossings for this year. We average about pedestrians, about 130,000 pedestrians a month cross a bridge. Vehicular traffic, about 315,000 to 320,000 cars go across our bridges in Idaho County. And I thought, you know, before you do that, and you stop people going southbound, I mean, there's half hour, hour, 4 hour rates going northbound because of checkpoint.
Yeah.
And so before they do that, I hope you take these numbers up there and say, before you do your study, you can't cripple our border. We need to have a safe border, doesn't mean a closed border.
Yeah, definitely. And I think that's why in any type of legislation, addressing the criminal activity, the human smuggling and all that is definitely something that we need to make sure the laws we have on the books are strong enough to put those people away, especially those that are putting individuals in harm's way. But on the flip side, when you look at southbound checkpoints or any type of southbound activity, one, the state needs to seek out local law enforcement participation because there are some cities that already put resources at the border.
Stolen cars, for instance, yeah.
That do have 24/7 southbound operations at the bridges that have video, that have surveillance, that have canines, doing a lot of the same things that I think they would need to do. So it would be nice for them to ask for their opinion and develop a solution that encompasses all of that.
Well, I think you ought to propose an amendment that we do that at DFW in Houston Hobby. We have South, anybody gets on a plane that's going to Central America or South Mexico has to have a checkpoint there.
Because one of the things that I've been very cognizant about, especially on the southbound checkpoints, is that if you don't have local participation and you just allow one person or one agency to say where they need to go, the risk that we run as a community is that people will no longer want to use those bridges and use the other, maybe ones around them, and you know, you have toll revenue that goes down, you have so many collateral issues. But if you have local input participation, I mean, we can make it happen. We just want to be at the table and part of the discussion.
And there's political pressure to do something because people have said that. And so the DPS, head of DPS, when he has to go back to Austin and say, what did you do? He's not going to be, you know, it's going to be very difficult for him to say, hey, I think they got it under control, or we don't need to have the emphasis that maybe the legislature thinks so. And so hopefully the feasibility study comes out good.
Yeah, and the one thing that I do think is very important to note, and it's something that I think we all need to communicate to the leadership of this state, especially in Austin, and whether it's the DPS or other departments, is let's not lose sight of the reality and the facts that we're dealing with on a daily basis. Let's not ignore the fact that as community partners, our international trade, we play a big role on the food that is on the table of a lot of the people in this state and in this nation. So let's be mindful in terms of the decisions we're making. We are not going to argue against having a safe community and not putting the criminals away and doing what is necessary, but let's also be mindful of our economic impact to this state as well.
Well, there you go. We solved all the problems just in time for the show to end. So,
yeah, we don't need to go back to session. We figured everything out down here. So we're
thanks a lot for being here. I really appreciate it. Good luck in Austin. We'll hopefully have you back soon.
Yeah, well, thank you, Mayor, and thank you to everybody here on behalf of the city of McAllen. It's been an honor to work and represent you all in the legislature, and also look forward to continuing to work to improve the life for all of us down here in the Valley.
So, well, thank you.
Thank you.
And this has been your City of McAllen Legislative Update. Thank you.